Number today, which might be good, inshallah, hopefully. The last 2 days, I was addressing the parents mainly. And today, inshallah, I will be addressing the teenagers and the younger ones in general. The theme of this lecture will be basically a conversation with a child or a teenager who feels hurt or traumatized. And I will be talking, basically, I'll be addressing to the teenagers, the younger ones, and even the ones who used to be teenagers, but they have some hurt. And this hurt probably came to them from a parent, a father or mother, or a teacher, or a relative, or a friend, it could be. Because in life, you know, when we are kids, we are very vulnerable. And it's easy for an outsider to take advantage of us. We are vulnerable as well to bullying from someone else in school or within the wider family. And it's possible as well that a loving, caring parent, out of their extreme concern for their son or their daughter, they might cause some harm. It could be emotional. It could be sometimes physical. And what happens, this kind of hurt or trauma, it goes on sometimes to destroy this child's life. Or to put it more accurately, this person, this child, grows and then decides at some stage of their life that what happened to me was tragic, was a disaster, and I can't function like a normal human being anymore. Now, the reason as well why this topic was chosen is that oftentimes when people have issues and problems, they decide to misbehave in the sense they decide to go into something that is haram, that is forbidden, something that is bound to ruin their life and cause them a lot of trouble, like for example drugs, or maybe relationships outside the wedlock. And sometimes, as I said, improper, unacceptable sexual orientation or behavior. Or maybe sometimes getting into or being rebellious to parents, undutiful and disrespectful to parents. Or maybe deciding sometimes to give up faith altogether, to give up Islam altogether, and to keep oneself disconnected completely from the Muslim community. Usually people who've been through some kind of hurt, some kind of trauma, some kind of mistreatment, some kind of tragedy in their life that left a scar in their hearts, they take this as the springboard and as the reason not to behave well, not to hold themselves to a higher standard in life. And this is merely a myth and a fallacy. Because if you look around, looking at statistics, by the way, in North America, just to show you how even sometimes sexual abuse and molestation is so common. And by the way, some people think when they have not been through this experience, they think it's quite easy. Or you can just forget about it and move on in life. Statistics say in North America that one out of three children has been subjected to some kind of sexual abuse and molestation. And the majority of these cases, the molestation or the abuse happens from someone within the family. This is emotionally very destructive, very disturbing, and this is a scar that stays with the person for the rest of their life. What about other emotional trauma? Some parents, out of their love and concern for their children, they might be very strict. Maybe that's the kind of upbringing they had. That's the kind of environment they grew up in. So they decide, in order to raise their kids and cultivate them, they see that's the only way. Be harsh with the child. Be very strict, be very critical. Chase after them, catch them doing their mistakes, and then punish them and discipline them. And be very critical of them. Put them down so that they become strong. Toughen them up by being harsh with them. As I said, this might sometimes work with a minority, but with the majority, this leaves an emotional scar in the heart, and sometimes, specifically with sensitive children. There are human beings that are sensitive. And they are not a minority. They are between 30 to 40% of children are emotionally sensitive. So for them, you might tell them off and think that's normal. But for them, this will leave them traumatized. It will risk and it will shake their self-image and their identity as a human being. And this will stay for them maybe for the rest of their life if they don't know how to handle that. So this is why seeing this as the reason for many people to make mistakes. And by the way, I've been speaking to a brother from the UK that has an interest in the so-called ex-Muslims. So-called ex-Muslims. And he investigated some of the famous ones that have been writing books, have been very vocal and public. They appear in public arenas. They show their rejection for Islam and why they actually share with people their story or their so-called story that we were Muslims, we were brought up Muslims, or we came into Islam at some stage, we practiced Islam for such and such years, we learned this, we studied this, we were practicing, people know us, famous Muslim personalities know us very well, we were very close to them, and now we're looking at Islam and it doesn't make any sense. Then they say, blah, 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 this is why the reasons, these are the reasons, the Prophet ﷺ did this and that, this doesn't make sense, this goes against humanity, Islam tells you to do this, this is against humanity. So this person had an interest, and he's been investigating, reading their books and watching their meetings or the interviews they had on media outlets, on newspapers, and following personally some of them, having personal interviews with them. And he says the common denominator among these people went through some trauma early on in their lives or through the years they practiced Islam. Sometimes people through our community, and we have to admit this, generally speaking, in the Muslim community, you will find a lot of negativity. People are very reserved, good people are very reserved. Some people are very critical because we come from different cultures, different cultural backgrounds. And we communicate in different ways that, and we don't necessarily understand each other very well. You might come across, you might want to advise someone, you want to teach someone, and you think you're doing them a favor, but in your culture, doing this in a harsh manner is actually praiseworthy and is good. So you go about approaching that person in your natural way, which is tough, and which might be aggressive and critical, and that person really feels hurt. They're not used to that. So they take a personal grudge against it, against that, they take it personal, and if it happens over and over again, these people become disillusioned with the Muslim community. And if their faith is not strong enough, and if there is enough temptation on some side, and there is enough challenge approaching them from the opposite side, they might decide, they might lose their mental and heart toughness, their faith, the toughness of their faith, and they might actually succumb to doubting iman and faith and start questioning it. Because we human beings are not completely even logical. Even though I know this faith, I feel this faith is true, and I have enough logical reasons to believe in it, but if I'm emotionally hurt, this emotional hurt wants to express itself. It wants to be healed. And if it's not treated well, it will pop up from, when you suppress it, it will pop up from another side and it wants to express itself and it will justify itself. It will find a way to rationalize that tendency. So a lot of those so-called ex-Muslims, according to this brother who's been investigating their cases, he says this reason pops up over and over again in most of the cases. These people were hurt by Muslims, either a family member, mainly a parent, or by the wider Muslim community. They've been mistreated. They have not been appreciated. They've been traumatized by the Muslim community. Or at least maybe they were sensitive. So they couldn't take it. And they kept that for years, and it kept they kept processing it emotionally. And then it developed into a state of aversion and hatred to Islam, and then questioning Muslims. Maybe all of these Muslims are not behaving well. Obviously, you know, when you are hurt by two or three people, you start to, we have the tendency to generalize. So you would look at everyone around, everyone in the Muslim community, in the sense that these people are no good. These people don't treat, they don't have respect. They don't have mercy for one another. Everyone is concerned about themselves. Everyone is, you know, on the lookout for mistakes. They want to catch your mistakes. They want to pinpoint your mistakes and make you feel bad about them. It's probably a handful of these people, a minority among the Muslim community, but unfortunately, you know, we tend to generalize as human beings. That's how it works. And when you generalize, you'll always be on the defensive against other people. You'll expect them, and you would interpret any words they say or any behavior that comes from them in a negative sense. Someone approaches you, straight away you're going to be on the defensive, thinking and anticipating that this person is approaching me to criticize me and put me down. So you're going to put on an attitude. You'll be defensive. The person will pick up that attitude. Why are you being aggressive towards me? Well, you are trying to defend yourself. So they will see an attitude from you that is aggressive because you're trying to be defensive. So they will respond in kind. And they will be somehow aggressive because they're trying to be defensive. So you, both of you guys, misinterpret each other. And by the way, this is the same mechanism that destroys marriages. If you want to destroy a marriage, just implant a doubt in the mind of the husband or the wife about their spouse. That's it. They don't have to see evidence. They start to look at the wife, oh, where did she go today? Why didn't she tell me? Okay, she was supposed to be away for 2 hours, and now she spent 3 hours outside of the house. What did she do in that extra hour? Where did she go? Who was she with? Who was she talking to? You go and check her phone, right? Check the call log, okay, numbers. Who did she talk to? She sees you spying on her phone, trying to see what she was. She says, what's wrong with him? Why is he treating me like that? And it will show on your behavior. She will pick up the attitude, and it will become mutual from both sides. Then it escalates, and it gets to a point where these guys or these two spouses cannot solve it anymore. They cannot even speak the same language because you're coming from doubt. And the reason for that is one word. One word. So that's the same mechanism. Anyway, so a lot of these ex-Muslims, basically, the reason for them to arrive at this conclusion or make this decision to leave Islam, whether it was genuine, real, maybe a real story, or was a fake and made up story, it seems to be that there is some kind of trauma or emotional pain that they went through, some kind of mistreatment. So, the reason we're talking about this today is that it's about the Muslim family and the challenges that face the Muslim family. So specifically talking today to the youth, that maybe you have been hurt by a parent. Maybe your father was very harsh and critical and strict with you. Maybe. Maybe your mother wasn't there for you. Maybe she didn't listen to your complaints. Maybe she didn't listen to your feelings. Maybe she wasn't supportive enough. Maybe she didn't teach you enough what you needed to learn. Maybe your parents did not really prepare you to deal with the bigger society. Maybe they did not prepare you to deal with the doubts that you are facing today and the kind of aggression that you find in society. You know, life is hard. Maybe you feel they did not do enough and you look at other people, their parents did better than your parents. You feel traumatized, you feel hurt, you feel less fortunate, and you take it on your parents. And the moment you do this, you'll start losing your life and your future. The nature of this life, and I say this repeatedly, the nature of this life that it will never be rosy. It will never be nice and dandy. This life is a test. It's a challenge. There are ups and downs. There will be difficulties. There will be traumas. There will be hurts. You will have very difficult circumstances to deal with. You will be mistreated. People will have evil suspicion about you. People will judge you. People will criticize you. Sometimes you will be even physically mistreated. That's going to happen. Sometimes for the younger ones, you might be sexually molested. I'm not saying this is all okay. This is wrong and this is false. And the ones who get involved in something like this, they will be punished by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will hold them to account. But what I'm saying, if something bad happened in your life, from a parent or a relative or a sibling or a friend or a teacher or a complete stranger, you don't have to spend your life living that trauma over and over again and cancel your future life just for something happened in the past. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us a very powerful core. A very powerful core, which is like a recovery disc, that no matter what happens in your life, you can recover and you can heal completely. And the hurt that you experienced or the trauma that you went through could become a source of inspiration in your life. A source of inspiration in your life. How often you find in life someone who's been, for example, maybe raped as a child. They decided later on to heal and dedicate their life, and not to live their life as a victim, but to dedicate their life to make sure to protect people or to protect vulnerable children in similar position? How often? How often someone was physically assaulted and attacked and they decided to take up the challenge, to rise up to the moment, and they learned some kind of self-defense or martial arts, and they started teaching people for free in poor communities, in impoverished communities and countries, to teach them how to defend themselves. How often a woman was attacked or was maybe sexually attacked, then she decided to create a system of verbal defense and physical defense to help women protect themselves against such attacks. And they made this the message of their life or the calling of their life. And they refused to succumb to a spirit of defeat that I have to live by that trauma. Alhamdulillah, most of us have not been through such a severe trauma where we have to go through a lot in order to heal from that and grow out of it. But humans have the tendency to blow out of proportion and exaggerate whatever they went through. Whatever they went through. The other day I was listening to one of the a Muslim speaker, and he was talking about people going through so much trauma. He was talking about people in who used to be in Palestine, people in Burma today, people in Syria, people in Iraq, some people today in Egypt, and other countries. What they go through as children as well. The kind of murder and killing and blood and bodies that they see in their lives, the kind of viciousness and inhumanity that they witness on a daily basis, how they are violated day in and day out. Then he says, everyone have their own trauma. He mentions the story of someone, a very well-off Muslim man, businessman, in his community, that walked into his office, and he was the imam. He walked into his office and he was literally in tears. He was traumatized and he was crying. A man, an adult, who had children, he had a family. And he was crying, bitterly crying. So he said, I thought something bad happened in his family. He lost a child, he lost his spouse, or he lost his money, his business, completely. So he asked for an appointment, for a meeting, and I sat with him, he said. I sat with him and I asked him, what was it? He said, you know, every year I go, I take my children on vacation to Europe. Every year. But this year, I don't have enough finances to take my children to Europe. And I don't know how to tell my kids that today this year we can't go to Europe. He was traumatized. So we human beings, regardless of what you went through, regardless of what you went through, we always find a trauma to hold on to and hang our pains and our frustrations and mainly our failures on that. Most humans do this. But the Prophet ﷺ tells us something very important. He says, لا تكونوا إمعات. لا يكون أحدكم إمعا. Let none of you be إمعا. What's إمعا? It's more of a copycat. You just follow everyone else. You copy everyone else. A copycat. إن أحسن الناس أحسنتم وإن أساءوا أسأتم. Don't be like إمعا. If people do good, you do good. If they do bad, then you do bad. ولكن وطنوا أنفسكم أن إذا أساء الناس أحسنتم. But make sure or make a commitment to yourself that if people do wrong, you do well. So the Prophet ﷺ encouraged this kind of individuality where you do not succumb to a victim mentality. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ again says in the hadith, احرص على ما ينفعك. You know, pay great attention and be so keen to get what is good for you, what is beneficial for you. In matters of this dunya, you want to grow in your studies, you want to grow in your health, you want to grow socially, you want to grow professionally, you want to grow in whatever specialization you are in sports, wherever you have your aspirations, any field, you want to grow there, then احرص على ما ينفعك. Seek and be keen to get whatever benefits you, obviously within the legitimate and lawful means. واستعن بالله ولا تعجز. And not only in worldly matters, but in matters of the dunya, in matters of the deen. What most benefits you? Connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Love for Allah. Worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Learning your deen, Islam, so that you know the way that takes to paradise. And you learn how to protect yourself from the punishment of Allah. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, واستعن بالله ولا تعجز. And seek the help of Allah and never fall in helplessness. Never fall in helplessness, no matter what happens, no matter what you've been through. So I will share with you certain tips on how to avoid succumbing to this kind of victim mentality, no matter what the hurt you've been through is, no matter what the trauma that you had to go through was. Some tips that will help us rise above the challenge, heal our pains and our scars, and move on in life and use these scars and these pains to propel us to do something of significance. Number one, believing in the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Learning and knowing for sure that everything that happens in your life was destined to happen. And it was written in a book and it was documented that it could not be changed 50,000 years before the creation of the heavens and the earth. That's what the Prophet ﷺ says. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, مَا أَصَابَ مِن مُصِيبَةٍ. There is no tragedy, musibah, calamity, a disaster. مَا أَصَابَ مِن مُصِيبَةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ. On earth, وَلَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ. On earth or in yourselves, in your personal life, in your social life, in you as a person, any tragedy, any calamity that hits you, إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ, except that it is written in a book. مِن قَبْلِ أَن نَبْرَأَهَا, before we create it, before we bring it into existence. So first it was a word, and then it became a creation. And there was no way to go against this. There's no way. There's nothing more powerful in this universe than a word from Allah, that is kun, whose time has come. If something is destined and meant to happen, it will happen no matter what. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِكَيْ لَا تَأْسَوْ عَلَى مَا فَاتَكُمْ. Allah is explaining, why is He telling us this? لِكَيْ لَا تَأْسَوْ عَلَى مَا فَاتَكُمْ. So that you do not despair and you do not ruminate and you not become excessively sad over what happened to you. Things that happen to you, because usually when people repeat and play over and over again in their mind, their trauma and their hurt and their tragedy, they live it over and over again with the hopes that they could go back in time and change it. Humans by nature, they do not go over the trauma. No one wants to feel the hurt again. No one wants to live it again. But there's a trick that Shaitan plays on your mind that makes you always go back to the trauma. He gives you the false hope that you can go back in time and change it. That you can go back in time and change it. And that's why you keep playing it over and over again. Otherwise, you would not naturally go over the trauma again. And this is something explained by the Prophet ﷺ when he said, وَلَا تَقُلْ لَوْ أَنِّي فَعَلْتُ كَذَا لَكَانَ كَذَا. Do not ever say, had I done this, it would have been different. Only if, don't use this. Then the Prophet ﷺ said, فَإِنَّ لَوْ تَفْتَحُ عَمَلَ الشَّيْطَانِ. Because لَوْ opens the way for Shaitan to start working. Working on what? What does Shaitan work on? On your mind and your heart. He throws and he injects false ideas and hopes that you could go back and change it. Why? Because he wants you to relive the trauma over and over again. Because Shaitan loves that you feel sad. Shaitan wants that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا النَّجْوَى مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ لِيَحْزُنَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. إِنَّمَا النَّجْوَى مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ لِيَحْزُنَ. The Prophet ﷺ says, whispering, Shaitan causes some people to whisper in the presence of another person. Why? In order to hurt the other person. Shaitan wants you to feel sad. Shaitan wants you to feel sad. Imam Ibn al-Qayyim says in Madaraj al-Salikin, he says basic sadness is normal. But if you keep repeating it and playing it over and over again, he says this is from Shaitan. And one of the best ways to fight against Shaitan is not to fall into sadness. He says, be happy so that you give Shaitan a hard time. You traumatize Shaitan when you are happy. That's true. Shaitan wants you to be sad. لِيَحْزُنَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. So the believers, the third person who's seeing these two people whispering, thinking they're talking about him, they're backbiting him, they're judging him, he feels sad, he feels hurt. That's what Shaitan wants. Shaitan wants you to feel bad. Don't forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌّ. that shaitan is truly an enemy for you. فَاتَّخِذُوهُ عَدُوًا. Take him as an enemy. Shaitan wants to make this life miserable for you and the next as well. And he knows how to do it. So you never fall into despair. You never play that out. Remember that this is the decree of Allah. And when Allah subhanahu, this is something very important to remember about the decree of Allah. If Allah allows something to happen, there are three things, three names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that have to do with everything Allah allows to happen. With every qadr, every occurrence, every circumstance, every condition, everything that takes place, there are three of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala behind it. If you keep them in mind, they will put your heart in peace. First, Al-Aleem. Second, Al-Hakim. Third, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Everything that happens behind it, first of all, is the knowledge of Allah. When Allah allowed it to happen and Allah created it, it came from the vast, encompassing knowledge of Allah that this is the best thing to happen. This is the best possibility. Number two, Al-Hakim. Al-Hakim, that means putting everything in its right place, making the best thing happen. If any other possibility happened, it would be worse than whatever happened in your life. This is why also Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim says in one of his books, he says, Wallahi, لو فتح الله أو لكشف الله غطاء الغيب. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removed the screen from the world of the unseen so you can see it. وأطلع الإنسان على ما لم يكن لو كان كيف كان يكون. Even Arabs find it difficult to understand this statement. لو كشف الله أو لو رفع الله حجاب الغيب وأطلع عبده على ما لم يكن لو كان كيف كان يكون. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the unseen to his servant and showed him the other possibilities of any scenario that never happened, if they happened, or if they had happened, how they would be, or how life would look like, لذاب قلب العبد حياء من الله عز وجل لعظم رحمته عليه. The heart of the servant would melt down out of shyness before Allah and out of recognition of how merciful Allah has been to him or her. So any other possibility that you wish was, let go of it. It's a delusion. It's imagination. The best thing happened in your life. It could never be better than that. It just could never. If it were any, even slightly different, it would have been worse for you in the final tally. So that's the word of the name of Allah, Al-Hakim, that Allah knows what to bring into your life for your own sake, for your own benefit, for your own goodness. Allah knows what to, Allah chooses carefully what to bring into your life. Nothing happens randomly. We live in a universe where there are no mistakes. Even if it's someone who's been sexually molested, yes. Even if it's someone who's been completely violated, yes. Even if it's a child witnessing probably the murder of his or her own parents, yes. Yes. This was the best thing that could ever happen for that person. In that moment, in that point in time. If things were otherwise, it would not be optimal for that person. And we are speaking from our narrow parentheses in reality, our narrow vision about other possibilities and everything. And we think we know it all. We don't know nothing. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. And He's wise, so He chooses carefully for you what happens in your life in order to optimize your chances to enter paradise. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala works. There's nothing random. Nothing random in this universe. Even the pants you're wearing now are not random, by the way. The breath, the air molecules that you are breathing in today are designed by Allah, particularly to go into your lungs at this moment. Nothing random. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says there's nothing in the universe that's random. Even a leaf that falls off a branch of a tree. where it falls, how it decomposes, where it ends up, how it comes back together again, where these molecules and these atoms, where they end up, each one of them has a record, and it's running according to its pre-designed course. That's the universe we're working in. That's the universe we're living in. That's what we're dealing with. That's the wisdom of Allah. Nothing random. Your seat today, where you're sitting, was designed by Allah, was meant there for a reason. You might not realize it, but it's there. There's not, this, in this universe, there's no randomness, there's no coincidence, there is no mistakes. Everything is well planned, everything is happening according to plan, and for a good reason. And the third name, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Whatever happens in your life, don't ever question the mercy of Allah. Don't ever question the mercy of Allah. This, anything that is happening according to the mercy of Allah. And it could never be better than that. It could never be better than that. And how often people go through trauma, go through hardship, and that's the reason for them to wake up and make good use of their lives. And this is something that's known today in science. You know, look at countries where people have been displaced. People have been kicked out of their land. Look at the Palestinians. Who's an Arab here? Who lived in the Arab world? Who lived in the Arab world here today? If you lived in the Arab world, specifically the Middle East, you know, usually Palestinians stand out. In my country, Jordan, Palestinians are probably 60 to 65% of the population, more than the indigenous people. Who usually stands out in business, in studies, in everything? It's the Palestinians. Usually when a people are traumatized, usually they rise up to a higher level because they need to deal with the moment. They need to rise up to the challenge. So that brings about everything inside them. And it causes them to grow. And that's what's called in science, post-traumatic growth. Post-traumatic growth. We think when a trauma happens, it means the destruction of the life of the person. But Allah knows better. Look at how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed the persecution of the early Muslims in Mecca. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow them to go through so much hardship? Bilal radiallahu anhu, one day in Medina, he uncovered his back and he showed and chest, and he showed the companions the marks and the scars on his skin, on his chest and his back, of the torture that he used to receive in Mecca. Khabbab ibn al-Arat was sitting with these companions and he says, well, that's bad enough, but let me show you my back. So he uncovers his back, and the companions were appalled completely at what they saw. They saw a completely mutilated back. So Khabbab al-Arat explains, he says, لَقَدْ رَأَيْتُنِي وَأَهْلُ مَكَّةِ قَدْ أَخَذُونِي وَخَلَعُوا قَمِيصِي ثُمَّ أَوْقَدُوا لِي نَارًا ثُمَّ أَنَامُونِي عَلَيْهَا فَمَا أَطْفَأَهَا إِلَّا وَدَكُ ظَهْرِي. He says, the people of Mecca took me one day, they took off my qamis, my thawb, they uncovered my body, they lit a huge fire for me when it was ripe, was like the highest degree, most burning, they put my back on it. They put my back on it, and the only thing that made the fire go out was the melting fat from my back. Then Khabbab ibn al-Arad goes to the Prophet ﷺ and he says, Ya Rasulullah, when the Prophet ﷺ was in the shade of the Kaaba, he says, Ya Rasulullah, ألا تستنصر لنا؟ ألا تدعو لنا؟ ألا ترى ما نحن فيه؟ He says, O Messenger of Allah, don't you see what we're going through? Why don't you call upon Allah to get us out of this? Why don't you call upon Allah to, you know, find us a way out of this whole calamity, this whole persecution thing? The Prophet ﷺ sits up and he says, people before you, a person used to be brought in front of everyone, he would be sawed into two pieces, meaning he would be cut into two pieces slowly, dying slowly and painfully, and they would not give up their faith. And a person would be brought, and combs of iron were brought, and his flesh and nerves and skin would be combed away from his bones. You can't eat. You can't even imagine it because it sends shivers through your body. All the hair on your body stands up when it even imagines that. And he says, مَا يَرُدُّهُ ذَٰلِكَ عَنْ دِينِهِ. None of this causes a person to recant their faith or give it up. Then the Prophet ﷺ says, وَاللَّهِ لَيُتِمَّنَّ اللَّهُ هَذَا الْأَمْرِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shall complete and perfect this affair and this power of Islam until a person travels from Sana'a to Hadramaut, fearing none but Allah. Meaning that Islam will bring about peace and safety to people and tranquility. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed these early Muslims to go through this trauma. Why? Because that trauma and that persecution allowed them to grow. Imam al-Shafi'i understood that very well. One day a question came to him and a person said, Ya Imam, أَيُّهُمَا أَفْضَلْ أَنْ يُبْتَلَ الرَّجُلُ أَمْ يُمَكَّنْ. Which is better for the human being? To be tried and go through persecution and hurt and problems and tragedies, or for the person to be given power, to be empowered, be in a position of power where they have resources and they have a say and they can shape circumstances, they can shape, you know, the reality. Imam al-Shafi'i questioned the question itself. He says, وَهَلْ يُمَكَّنُ حَتَّى يُبْتَلَى. Would someone be truly given power and control unless they go through the persecution and the hardship? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests people, then Allah gives them the power. They have to go through the persecution for them to grow. Because oftentimes we're too lazy, oftentimes we're so laid back, and we do not respond to the challenge of life. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends hardship and sends persecution, maybe even when you are innocent, when you are a child. Maybe. Sends it your way so that this becomes, this instigates you. It awakens your motivations and your aspirations to do something of value, of significance in your life, to make a difference in the lives of others by utilizing your life. So remember, with the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's the main thing. And remember, behind it is the name Al-Aleem, Al-Hakim, Al-Rahman, Al-Rahim. These are the names of Allah behind it. And Allah has a point behind everything. Number two, forgiveness. Forgiveness. And when I say forgive, I don't say necessarily you do forgiveness for the sake of the other person. Not necessarily. Forgiveness is first and foremost for you. When you forgive, you relieve yourself. And you grow. And you grow. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised great reward for those who forgive. Those who forgive. And this is why there's a beautiful story that one of the Umayyad caliphs, he wanted to make wudu, and one of his servants, it was a slave. He was pouring the water for him to make wudu. Now, the servant did not pay enough attention. He overheated the water, so it was very hot. So when he started pouring the water and this Khalifa wanted to make wudu, it burnt him. So he became very angry and he wanted to make a statement basically to punish that. Probably, Allahu alam what it was, but at least would be maybe a few years of imprisonment. So he was about to pass a judgment or pass a sentence on that person straight away, in the moment of anger, in the heat of the moment. But that servant was very intelligent. He said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. He said, Wal-Kadhimeen al-Ghayd. He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Wal-Kadhimeen al-Ghayd. And the ones who hold back their anger, they bottle it up. They don't release it. They don't vent it out. You're angry now, hold it back. But this Khalifa was hafiz of the Quran. I think he was al-Walid bin Abdul Malik. So he was very careful with that. And he had respect for the words of Allah. So he said, when he told him, Wal-Kadhi min al-Ghaydi, he said, Kadhamtu Ghaydi. He said, I hold back my anger. He said, Wal-Kadhi min al-Ghayda, Wal-Afina an al-Nas. That's the verse. He completed the verse. وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ. And the ones who forgive. Not only hold back their anger, but they move a step forward and they forgive. So it's not they have a grudge and they hold it back. They don't act on it. No, they completely dissolve it. That's a greater stage. A higher stage. So he says, عَفَوْتُ عَنْكِ. I forgive you. But the slave or the servant is very intelligent. He's very learned. So he says, the continuation of the verse, وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. And Allah loves the ones who do excellence. or do excellence. That means more. So the Khalifa looks at him and he says, "Anta hurrun liwajhi Allah." You are free for the sake of Allah. You are free for the sake of Allah. Because that's ihsan. That's ihsan. So forgiveness is for you. If you hold on to the hurt, it will burn you first and foremost. The person who hurt you, regardless, as I said, whether they're a stranger, whether they're a family member, a parent, they've probably done that by mistake. Maybe that's the best they know as parents. That's the best they know. They gave you the best. And times keep changing. And keeping up with younger generations and what their real needs are is not easy. Is not easy. Your parents have done their best. Their best. You don't have to hold them to account. You don't have to hold grudges against them. You don't have to blame them for their mistakes. Because you see from your standing point what they don't see. They've done what they can. They've done the best from their point of view. That's all they can. So all you need to do, and I'm stressing this with parents because this is probably the most debilitating kind of hurt to hold on to if it comes from parents. Forgive them. Even if they were blatantly wrong, forgive them. Forgive them because if they have wronged you once and twice and 100 times, they have given you their heart. They've given you their time, their days and their years for you to grow up. And that's enough. They have all the right upon us to forgive them, no matter what they did. And I said, even if you don't feel you want to do it for them, do it for your own sake. Because when you hold on to a pain and a grudge and you want to retaliate, this will burn your life and will destroy your effort and it will waste your time. So, forgive, let go of the anger and the hatred and the grudge and you will grow. You will grow and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you greatly. And there are so many people, I read a lot of biographies and I've seen a lot of the great people. A lot of the people have achieved something in their life. The turning point in their life was when they decided to forgive the people who hurt them. And they hurt them really bad. When you forgive, it's different. Look at the Prophet ﷺ, how much the people hurt him. The people of At-Ta'if threw stones on him. He was bleeding. He was humiliated. That was probably the worst thing to happen to a person. Imagine you go into a nation or to a people hoping after your people, your own people have rejected you, hoping that these people will accept you. These people at least will respect you even if they turn you back. They will at least respect you. But these people spoke to the Prophet ﷺ in a very bad, disrespectful manner. Then they got, not them throwing stones at him, they got the little ones, the younger ones, and the mad ones against them to chase the Prophet ﷺ and throw stones at him and abuse. The Prophet ﷺ felt really hurt. He was bleeding. And he made that profound dua, one of the most, probably the profoundest dua the Prophet ﷺ ever made. When he says to Allah, إِن لَمْ يَكُن بِكَ عَلَيَّ غَضَبٌ فَلَا أُبَالِي. Oh Allah, if you're not angry with me, I don't care. Whatever happens, as long as you are pleased with me, I don't care. And he says, إِلَى مَن تَكِلُنِي. Who are you, you know, handing me over to? إِلَى عَدُوٍ يَتَجَهَّمُنِي. Or إِلَى صَدِيقٍ يَتَجَهَّمُنِي. It's a friend who's frowning at me and not dealing with me well. أو أم إِلَى عَدُوٍ بَلَّغْتَهُ أَمْرِي. Or an enemy whom you've handed my affair onto them. And he says, oh Allah, if you are not angry with me, nothing else matters. Profound dua. The Prophet ﷺ was hurt. Jibreel comes to him with the angel that is in charge of the mountains and he says, if you want, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could cause these mountains to collapse upon them and destroy them completely. He says, لا. لا فإني أرجو أن يخرج الله من أصلابهم من يوحد الله. No. I hope that one day Allah will bring from their own children, from their own backs, Allah will bring people who will worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And when the Prophet ﷺ was hurt and he was really like physically hurt in the battle of Uhud, when his own helmet, the sides of it went into his cheek and his tooth came out and he was bleeding profusely, his cheek was bleeding profusely, the Prophet ﷺ, what did he say? He says, Allahumma ighfir liqawmi fa'innahum la ya'lamun. Oh Allah, forgive my people, they don't know. That's not lip service. That's a beautiful heart. That's a caring heart. And this is why Allah gave him more and more, more victory. So when you forgive, don't ever think forgiveness is weakness. Forgiveness is not a loss. It's a victory because you're rising up to a higher moral ground that the other person can never tap into. You're just rising to a higher level of existence and being, and Allah will open up oceans of mercy for you that you were that were inaccessible for you before, just by means of emulating the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Afu wal-Ghafur. Allah is the one who forgives. People ascribe, specifically these days they're celebrating that, people ascribe a son to Allah, a begotten son, who's a human being. What could be more insulting than this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, تَكَادُ السَّمَاوَاتُ يَتَفَطَّرْنَ مِنْهُ. The skies are about to crack and split out of fear, trembling out of fear because of the gravity of the statement. تَكَادُ السَّمَاوَاتُ يَتَفَطَّرْنَ مِنْهُ وَتَنْشَقُّ الْأَرْضِ. And the earth is about to split and crack and to open out of fear of the anger of Allah because of this word. وَتَخِرُّ الْجِبَالُ هَدَّ. And the mountains are about to collapse out of fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because something, this kind of insult was spoken against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not punishing these people. He's letting them go. And He's allowing many of them enough time that they consider and reconsider, and many of them come into Islam when they face the truth, when they come face to face with the truth. So if Allah Himself is not even avenging Himself, why would someone like you and me, when we don't even own ourselves, we don't even belong to ourselves, who are you and who are me? Who's me? Who am I? Nothing. We just belong to Allah, that's it. We don't even belong to ourselves. So let go of anger, let go of revenge and retaliation, no matter what, and you will grow. Number three. If a trauma happened to you, and that's probably, I'll close with this. I think I'll run out of time, I'm not sure. I'm not being given any indications. But this is very important. And this follows from the name of Allah Al-Hakim. Nothing happens randomly. If you've been traumatized, mistreated, some kind of emotional pain has been caused, scar has been created in your life, it's not random. It's not random. It happened for a reason. And if you look around in great people in history, whether Muslims or non-Muslims, people who had great contributions, if you look into their lives, usually their contribution was shaped by their suffering. By their suffering. Because they went through so much trouble, they went through this trauma and this hurt, and they felt it so dearly. So they want to make sure that they fix this once and for all. And they don't want other people to go through the same. So this is why these people fix these problems, and this is why they achieve. Because they're intimately connected to that. They feel it deep in their hearts. So usually whatever happens in your life is a communication from Allah. Is a communication from Allah. So your hurt, the trauma you went through, was not random. It was meant to happen to you. It was meant to come to you, and not for any foolish or random purpose or reason. There's no accidents in this universe, no coincidences. Everything has been pre-planned, and everything happens according to plan. And nothing, not even an atom, not even water is placed here for random reason. We don't have access to all of these wisdoms. We only have access to tiny wisdoms. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tries you with hardship or trauma or physical or emotional pain, this is an indicator that probably you were meant to go through this. So your attention goes into that area so that you fix it. Because no one can relate to it as you can, because you have a personal experience with it. And the word that summarizes everything we've been talking about is trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we truly develop trust in Allah, we don't have to develop techniques and tactics. Just your state of trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the state of trust is enough to make you deal with every situation perfectly. Any of these situations. And this is the final notion that I will leave you with, inshallah. As humans, we have 5 minutes. Really? Okay. I'll consider this to be a gift. These 5 minutes were designed, and they were meant to come 50,000 years before the creation of the heavens and the earth. And now here they come. Serious. Now I'm going to find out what I need to talk about. So, we humans need to make sense of things. We need to make sense of things. Making sense. And the reason people suffer after their calamity and they do not heal and they do not outgrow their pain is their failure to make sense of their suffering. You can endure anything in life if you can make sense of it. What does it mean to make sense of it? If you can find a good purpose for it. And the only thing that will really help you make sense of whatever happens is trust in Allah, knowing that Allah is in charge. Because there are traumas where you can make sense of them. Maybe that was meant to happen to me so that no one else suffers afterwards. From now on, I'm going to make sure no one goes through the same again. Okay, you figured that out, it made sense to you, perfect, you found a good purpose. But sometimes there are traumas where people can't really figure out a purpose for them or make sense of them. They just can't make sense of them. How can you deal with this? Trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He says in Ayatul Kursi, وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ. Allah gives us access to what He knows, only to a limited percentage of that. He doesn't allow us access to everything He knows. And this is why people who want an explanation for everything that happens in the universe, every suffering, every calamity, every occurrence, every stage in history, and they need an interpretation, an explanation for why it happened, or the suffering of kids, or why do babies and infants have to suffer and go through illness and cry and go through pains? Why do they have to suffer? People who don't believe in Allah, they can't find a reason. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ. Allah does not allow you knowledge of what He knows except for a small percentage. So if there is some knowledge that Allah kept hidden away from you and you can't find it, that's when you say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. I don't know. I just belong to Allah. I know I belong to Allah and I will return back to Allah. Allah, that's His universe. That's His dominion. I'm just His creation, His slave. He's free to do whatever He wants with me. And the people who manage to tap into this, they live in a state of happiness. Because the trauma, and you know, once you tap into this, there's something beautiful that happens. Whatever trauma you go through, physical, emotional, social, whatever, will be minimized. Do you know there are people who can completely cancel out pain, physical pain, by their focus? Sometimes people call it pain suppression. But others don't like to call it that because it's not suppression. You know, sometimes you might have a toothache or you have any kind of pain in your body and it's really hurting you. Then something comes on TV or you receive a phone call about something very interesting and you're drawn into it, you completely forget about your pain. The pain is there. The pain is really there. Where did it disappear? It's still there. But because your attention was taken away completely from it, you don't feel it anymore. So when our attention is with Allah and we believe in the wisdom of Allah and that Allah is in charge and that Allah doesn't do things randomly and everything Allah does, He does it out of His knowledge, out of His wisdom and out of His mercy. Once we truly believe in this, this will consume our attention in a very positive sense and it will minimize whatever hurt we go through. And you will start to see any hurt, any pain, any trauma I'm going through is just touching me on the surface. It's like a mosquito bite. It's just a mosquito bite. And that's why faith is very empowering. But we don't use it. We don't utilize it. We don't take advantage of it. For us, faith is about, okay, I memorize, believe in Allah, believe in the angels, believe in the last day, and repeat it. You ask me, I repeat it. I can name it quickly without any hesitation. But do I implement it? Does it shape my mindset? Does it help me go through life? Does it help me rise over my challenges? That's the question, and that's the challenge. Because iman and faith is there for us to live it, not to only to memorize it. Memorizing is just a tool to help us. That's it. But the point is to live it. It's a way of life. Now, how many of those 5 minutes are left? Again, let me conclude with the younger ones. And even the younger ones who have grown up and now they are in their 20s, maybe 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, and maybe 70s. Because by the way, and this is something very helpful in marital life, you know, men are just big boys, big children. And women are just big girls. We are babies, we're big babies, that's it. So if you have a beard, even if your hair is white, you're just a big baby. You still have the baby inside you. You just have a rough voice and maybe some white hairs and some wrinkles. Maybe you look old, maybe you have a bald head, but you're still a baby. That's how we human beings are. So even though we've grown, we still live our trauma when we were young. The hurt that we had when we were 3 years old, 5 years old, we still hold on to it. How often that we still remember, even someone in their 70s, they remember one situation with their father when they had some hope in their father and their father just let them down. Unknowingly, he didn't mean it, but it was a miscommunication. They still remember it, and when they remember it, they feel emotional. They feel emotional. We're human beings, we're still babies. So the point is, if you live and relive your trauma over and over again and decide to make it the hanger on which you hang your failures and your disappointment and your lack of motivation and your lack of ambition and your lack of proper functioning, that's your choice, and you will be held accountable for the consequences of all those choices. To be hurt, to be traumatized is human, is common human experience. Even if it's like that rich man who couldn't take his kids that year to Europe for vacation. Everyone is traumatized. Everyone is traumatized. Everyone has been through some hurt. And everyone sees their hurt as the ultimate one. By the way, I talk to a lot of people and everyone tells me the same statement. You know, my story is a bit different. My childhood is a bit different than everyone else. And I sometimes tell them, believe me, mine as well is different. That's how we are human beings. That's our uniqueness. So we see ours as unique. We see our trauma as the worst. We see our childhood as the most difficult. We all have this, regardless, regardless. So what you need to do, the challenge of life is not to number your traumas and your hurts and to tell the world about them. By the way, everyone in the world is happy to tell you about their suffering. Everyone. You want people to talk to you? Just tell them, okay, tell me about your suffering. They will talk to you for hours and days. For hours and days. And if you try and have you, try this out and you will see it. You know, find someone who would listen to you, start telling them about your suffering, and they would wait for the first possible pause in your speech until you, oh yeah, when I was a child, I had this, because they're dying to tell you and share their suffering as well. Share it and share it. Honestly, I'll tell you. Some people might care, but no one truly, truly, deeply cares. Everyone has their own suffering, their own problems to deal with. Move on. Move on. Confide in Allah. As Ya'qub alayhi salam said, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Yusuf, إِنَّمَا أَشْكُو بَثِّي وَحُزْنِي إِلَى اللَّهِ. The fact that you feel hurt is legitimate. But feel hurt and express it to Allah. Say, oh Allah, I've been hurt. And you know it. Please help me heal. Help me get over it. And reward me for my patience. And don't tell it to people. Forgive the person who caused you that pain and move on. And if you can, help them. If you can, help them. Because only hurt people hurt people. No one hurts you or traumatizes you from a position of comfort. These people are in a position of discomfort, no matter what they do. No matter what they do. People, if they hurt, they come from a position of discomfort and hurt. In their own way, you might not figure it out. So give people the excuses. Let Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala judge them. It's not for you to judge. Let Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala settle the accounts and the disputes on the Day of Judgment. Move on and make something substantial out of your life for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you will never regret it. And the day will come when you will probably thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, thank Him for the trauma. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us make very good use of our times and to help us heal from our traumas and our hurts and to make us people who make the best use of our lives, who can really make a difference and can offer people a lot of help and value for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward us for that. Jazakumullah khairan for listening and for your attendance. وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم.